mentioned that, I'll tell y'all one quick story, and some of y'all may not know this, but on March 24th, I died. My heart stopped. It was an electrical problem. The only reason I'm alive is because my wife, as a nurse, started breathing me, and two young, one cadet and one young lady at North Georgia College started giving me compressions. They kept it going. It took 3.5 hours to get me back. Before they put me on the ambulance to take me off North Georgia, the students there, and this is the reason I'm telling the story. I know this is, if some of y'all have already heard this story, but this impressed me. When they put me in the ambulance, some of the students there gathered around, students I didn't know, they just were at North Georgia, and they all stopped my wife before she got in the ambulance and said, "Do you mind if we pray with you?" Now, I don't know any better way to start off that journey. It took them 3.5 hours to get me back, a lot of prayers, a lot of concern from a lot of people. It's unbelievable when I'm here. All my doctors say it's a miracle. I figured I was a miracle, or God wanted me to come back working with the Tea Party. So you think you're glad to be here?
You're glad to be anywhere.
I'm glad to be anywhere. We don't often focus on this, but I'm going to make sure that everybody, I'd like to try and start a new tradition. Besides, as well as praying and the Pledge of Allegiance, I'd like for me to lead y'all in the mission statement of our Dawson Tea Party here, so that everybody knows what we think and what we're doing. This should be your elevator statement. And, you know, you need to help us. Hopefully, you'll help us bring in more people so that we can be more active and more informed in what's going on in our community, in Gainesville, in Dawsonville, in Atlanta, in Georgia, and the United States and the world. We have great speakers. I'll talk about that in a minute. But if somebody said, "What do y'all do at the Tea Party?" Well, I want y'all to read this with me, because this should be your elevator speech. If somebody steps on the elevator and you would say, "What do y'all do?" Well, this is what we do. The Dawson Tea Party is committed to civic education, promoting the cause of fiscal responsibility, constitutional limited government, and free markets. And that's what the association wrote a long time. And every Tea Party probably has a little bit different mission statement, but this is ours. This is your organization, and this is your mission statement. If you think we need to change it, you need to tell us, and we'll think about what we're doing. The people who you should talk to is our board. Al Lee Wessinger is a stalwart supporter, and that's the Al Lee back there. Yes. Does everybody say Al Lee? She's handled that for us again and again and always. Scott Yocum has been on the board here for this year. Pepper Pettit, I know everyone knows, believe it or not. Pepper, as old as he is at the Rolling Stones concert. It was something they got, you know, they got excited, they got tickets months ago, and then realized, oh. So, anyway. And Dow Victor handles our website, which we're looking for somebody to help us with our website. Guy also does our mailers, or our email blasts. He's had to move over to Hartland, Georgia, which is right close to South Carolina, and just can't drop by over here. But he's still helping us with the email mailers. We need his help. I'm handling the treasurer duties. Somebody help us with programs. I usually do that. What I usually do is visit other tea parties around the state, because I typically travel in my job. And it affords me the opportunity to go to North Georgia area, Carrollton, other places, and even tea parties in Alabama, and I try to travel along with that so I can meet different people in the organization. But that helps us get good speakers.
Are those paid positions?
Yes.
Yes.
And I skipped something. We're always in, since I'm treasurer right now too. I always like to point out that we have more cash than the federal government. We have about $600 or $700 in the treasury. So we don't try and raise a whole bunch of money. We try and raise enough to help us with literature and different things like that. This costs us $50 a month. used to be free, so we need your donations and purchases of books or raffles for the books. Helps us pay the bills and pull a little money in the bank. What we do with that is sometimes last year, and we're not going to have it this year, I don't know why, because it was so successful last year, is a joint picnic with the Republican Party and over at one of the parks on the lake. It was well attended. Greg, you were there.
Yeah.
It was well attended. They're not going to have it this year. I wish they would, but they've got to have it for next year in 2000.
A little bit closer to the primaries and all of that stuff.
Right, so that's probably why.
Well, that's when you'll be able to get all the politicians to show up, because they'll really be campaigning.
Everybody was there, and it was a great time to talk to everybody. So it was a great event, and that's where some of your donations go to, a few hundred dollars. But I always focus at our mission statement. Then Scott's going to help me a lot with the House committee arranging this. Now, who do we have speaking? Well, we've got tonight Lee Darragh, and I'll introduce him in a minute. But last month, we had Kevin Tanner and Steve Nooch came and gave us an update on legislative issues that have been going on in both the Senate and the House this past year. Kevin is really good about that. Steve is darn good about it, too. You know, they do breakfasts around town, but they're always willing to help out so that you understand. One of the things, since we're talking about that, is another organization. We're pretty active, or most of our members, although you don't have to be, are members of the Republican Party, or at least I am. Of course, we know we just had our convention. At the Foothills Women's Republican Party last week, we had David Boris talk. And if you remember David, he came and spoke to us last year. And he talked about the Islamic threat. And one of the things that he was pushing for is that we support House Bill 171. And House Bill 171 is concerning, well, let me read you part of it. It amends Chapter 3 of Title 1 of the Official Code of Georgia so to revise positions relating to the effect and enforcement of foreign laws, to provide that no court, arbitration panel, administrative agency, or other tribunal shall enforce a foreign law if doing so would violate the right guaranteed by the United States Constitution or the Georgia Constitution. Now, this was written by several House members, and it's on, just go on georgia.state.gov. You can look up House Bill 171 as you can with all the potential House bills. This is one that I'm personally going to ask Kevin to take an interest in this year, because we've seen, David, as David talks about, we've seen so many instances of Islamic law being used in the United States, across the United States. And we'd like to see that we can make it, at least make it law in Georgia, that if it's not an American law, but the U.S. Constitution, you shouldn't be using it. It's not, it doesn't, has no effect. So that's my personal opinion. I would like for it to be y'all's too, but this is one thing that we're going to focus on this month, House Bill 171. And maybe next month we'll have a little more information on that. Now, I don't know if y'all recognize this. Guy Victor, who does our email blast, has a real good sense of humor and was pretty creative too. And when I told him that Lee Darragh, our district attorney, was coming over to talk to us, he said, He dug back in the files and on the web, and he found a movie that was made in 1940 or somewhere in the 40s called District Attorney. And that was the marquee for it, Mr. District Attorney. And of course, this is Lee's picture. He went and got that posted and sent that on the web. So I thought it was pretty key. But I got a story to tell you about it too. When I showed it to Lee a minute ago, so it didn't surprise him, he said, well, you know, Mr. District Attorney was actually a radio show in the 30s. And I told him, well, I'm not old enough to know anything about that. I'm surprised that you are. So anyway, welcome Lee. Lee is originally born in New York, lived to Georgia at a young, tender age, been around Gainesville for years, was in private practice for a while, short while, but has always been prosecuting attorney. And that's the role he enjoys, and We're glad he does that because he does an awfully good job at it. So I'd like to turn it over to you, Lee.
Thank you.
He's going to talk for a while, but we have plenty of time for questions.
I thought I'd talk about several things. First of all, I thought I was invited here just to share some of Gordon Parker's delicious popcorn.
Yeah.
And then I was told that I got to speak. So, you know, hey, I thought I'd start out and tell you a little bit about myself in a little bit more detail. I went to law school at the University of Georgia. Graduated in 1978 there. Started a private practice in Savannah for about a year. And joined the prosecutor's office when I found out that my wife was pregnant and we were going to have our first child. Worked there until 1985. Went into private practice again for a very short time, about 9 months after that stint in Savannah. But then came and joined the district attorney's office in the Northeastern Judicial Circuit, which at that time was Hall County and Dawson County, as well as Lumpkin and White, in 1986. So I started there May 1, 1986. So I've been in the office now for 29 years in the district attorney's office. I was the chief assistant district attorney for Andrew Fuller, who's now Superior Court Judge. For a time, I was chief assistant DA for his successor, Rivian Sartain, and also chief trial assistant DA during the latter part of her term. Then I was the chief assistant DA for Jason Beal, who's now Superior Court Judge. And when he got appointed judge, I got the opportunity to become the district attorney. I was appointed by Governor Perdue in August of 2005, stood for election in 2006. And actually had to run a campaign. And that was a most interesting time in my life, let me tell you that. But was successful then and had not had the opposition in 10, 14, and hopefully not again in 18. So I've been prosecuting criminal cases for a long time, since 1979. And this is my life's work, I love it. Dale made a point to say that I was born in New York. I was, in fact, born in New York City. However, it was my first 4 months. Okay, I want everybody to understand. And then we moved to Atlanta, my family did. And we lived mostly in Atlanta. I lived in the rest of the country. And I lost the accent. But I've got three kids. My wife and I have been married 42 years. I've got three kids, and they have given us four grandchildren so far. And I don't think they're due yet, so it's been an exciting time in our lives for that. So that's a little bit about me personally. I wanted to spend a few minutes and talk to you about the district attorney's office, because I find that a lot of times folks just don't know the basics about our office, what it is that we do, how it is that we do it. And I'll talk about that briefly, and then Dale asked if I would address a couple of issues that y'all might be interested in. And one of them is grand jury process, particularly as it pertained to the Ferguson case in Missouri, but just generally speaking, how it works here, etc. And then he thought that y'all might be interested in no-knock provisions and search warrants. That seems to be of interest to many folks. And so I will address that in a little bit and give you some of the law concerning it, just as a matter of general interest. My office is in two counties. We are the Northeastern Judicial Circuit, Dawson County and Hall County. Lumpkin and White also used to be included, but they split off in 1992 and became part of a new circuit just north of us, the Enoda Circuit. And so that is Towns Union, Lumpkin and White that's up in that way as well. We are, as you can see simply by looking at a map, not the most northeastern circuit in Georgia, but that's the name of our circuit. At the time that it was named, we were. The eastern circuit started out in Savannah, that was the most eastern. And even though the Athens, Clark County, Oconee County circuit is southeast of us, it is known as the Western Judicial Circuit because it was named after the Eastern Judicial Circuit, that sort of thing. There are 49 judicial circuits in the state. and so therefore there are 49 district attorneys. Some individual counties also have solicitors of state court where there is a state court, and they prosecute misdemeanors. In Hall County, Stephanie Woodard is the solicitor of state court, and she prosecutes misdemeanors only. Now, in Dawson County, we don't have a state court. All the misdemeanors are prosecuted through the Superior Court, so we handle those cases as well. In both Hall County and Dawson County, then, we handle all of the felonies, from the most minor. A felony is defined as any crime that's punishable by 1 year or more, and a misdemeanor is up to 12 months. That is the way it's simply defined in that way. So we prosecute all of the felonies and all of the misdemeanors that are connected with those felonies in Hall County. And in Dawson County, we prosecute both classes of crime. So we prosecute, and one of the most serious crimes we prosecute on the misdemeanor level, of course, is driving under the influence. It kills and harms more people than any other crime that is prosecuted throughout this country, I would suggest, is that particular crime. So that is an important crime in our office. But prosecute everything all the way up to the murder, to death penalty cases. We've had at least one in Dawson County that we prosecuted as a death penalty case involving the death of Keith Evans back in 1991, about which there was some recent legislation passed after Tommy Lee Waltrip's death sentence was commuted, unfortunately, and over my objection and many people's to life without the possibility of parole. So we prosecute all sorts of cases along those lines. We do our jobs with 16 assistant district attorneys. So I have a lot of folks who are working for me who do a good job. Most of those ADAs are assigned in Hall County. Hall County is the larger county, obviously. But in Dawson County, we have 3 full-time assistant district attorneys. I'm going to be asking Mr. Burke for a 4th one, since he's not here tonight, I might as well tell you that I'm going to do that coming up soon, simply because of the scheduling issues that we have. It's kind of, sometimes all you can do to prepare is have a warm body with wall break in court at a particular time, and we feel like we need a 4th attorney in Dawson County. Most of my attorneys are assigned to Superior Court trial teams. In Hall County, we have 4 trial teams. 2 of them have 3 assistant DAs, and 2 of them have 2 assistant DAs. Those that have 3 assistant DAs, at least one of those attorneys has many additional duties. For example, my chief assistant district attorney, Juan Vance, has the additional duties of being chief, and she also takes in some of the younger ADAs that we have, and she helps train them, bring them along in court, etc. Those that have smaller caseloads, because they have a 3-person team, they usually have some additional duties over and above just the prosecution of their particular caseloads. They are supported in both counties by 3 groups of people. One of them is investigators. I have seven investigators across the 2 counties. I have 4 in Superior Court in Hall County and 1 in Juvenile Court in Hall County. And I have 2.5. I can put it that way, that one of those persons has other duties as well. Investigators in Dawson County. All of my investigators, except for that half person, are certified police officers, and they have experience in the various agencies they worked for before. But they then come to our office and work for us. And their primary duty is to help us to prepare cases for trial, making sure that we have all the information that we need from the various agencies who may have worked on a particular case, make sure that we can find all the people that we need. As you can imagine, on any criminal case, not everybody is working a 9-to-5 job and watching TV at night and going to bed. Sometimes the people we have to work with as witnesses are hard to find. They move quickly, they're not very stable folks, sometimes difficult, so that the investigators help us a lot in finding with you, making sure that people get to court when they need to be in court. But they're helping us mostly in preparing cases. And I don't know what we do without our investigators. In the case I mentioned before, the Dawson County death penalty case with 3 defendants, I had 2 investigators working with me personally. I tried that case. over a long period of time. And they had the case so prepared for me that all I had to think about was lawyering. I didn't have to think about the preparation so much. I mean, obviously, I worked with them, and we organized the evidence, and we organized the list of witnesses and what we're going to do. But I was able to concentrate on doing the lawyer as opposed to making sure that everything was in place, because they helped me make sure it was. I needed a piece of evidence, he was right there to hand it to me. I needed a photograph, he was right there to hand it to me, that kind of thing. So they're invaluable people. Another group of people that we have working for us are our victim witness advocates, or victim witness assistants, we call them by various names. These people are usually have a background in criminal justice or in social work of some kind. That they may have worked in a domestic violence women's shelter, for example. And they help us in working with victims to help the victims understand the process of their criminal case. They help us to stay in contact with them and comply with all the requirements of the law. Victims have gotten a lot more notice in the legislation in the last 20 years or so than they used to have. You know, it used to be with a victim, you know, sit down and shut up unless you're called to the stand and testify. And a lot of judges really kind of had that attitude. But the law and people in general just decided that victims needed more attention to that. And so we make sure we notify them and give them the opportunities to be in court and to speak to the case that they're involved in as victims, not just as testifiers, but in sentencing issues and everything else. I'll give you an example of a murder case. We might look at that murder case and we might decide, you know, looking at all this case, yes, we indicted it for murder, but there's some mitigating factors. There's this evidentiary issue or that evidentiary issue. So we might decide, you know, we really need to try to close this case to a voluntary manslaughter rather than the murder indictment. And the victim's family may disagree with that, you know, and that's fine. But we have those discussions with them. We get their input. We tell them what we're thinking about. On some occasions, we're actually swayed by their arguments to not do a certain thing. Sometimes we have to make decisions that they might not particularly care for. But they get the opportunity to give input to us. They get the opportunity to be in court and actually express themselves about what the sentence recommendation is, and get to tell the judge what they think about the recommendation, even what they think about us if they want to. But it's important to maintain good victim contact on both property cases, burglary cases. You know, there's nothing more invasive than somebody entering your home, whether you're there or not, except for personal crimes, obviously, which are more invasive than that. But that's a particularly disturbing kind of crime. And so it's important that we maintain contact with them, get their restitution figures, try to seek restitution and conditions that they need in the home. So this is what our victim witness people do for us. They also are involved in court because give them a list of witnesses. They got all the telephone numbers, and they're the ones that call after the court is open today and say, you need to be here tomorrow morning before the morning hours, or you need to be here tomorrow morning for tomorrow afternoon for the afternoon hours. So they keep people on call to try to make it convenient for them. The big ones are very important, working with children. I've tried many, many child molestation cases in my career, and I became pretty good at working with children, preparing them to talk about the most horrible things that have happened to them that many of you just don't want to hear. But our victim witness people are important to work with those children with us. You know, I'm not going to sit with a female child and have that child tell me about all the things that happened to her without one of my female victim witness assistants there helping with the process. So they're extremely important. And neither can I discount the and I got about the same number of investigators as I had victim witness people in both the counties. In Dawson County, I have a full staff of 11. I've got two investigators. I've got a half investigator, half victim witness person, two other victim witness persons, and administrative folks. So I've got a full staff of 11 people who are in Dawson County all the time. My primary, personal primary office is in Hall County, but I also come to Dawson County. Office daily basis about both the counties that we're involved in. So I don't want to discount the administrative people either. Our administrative folks are more than secretaries. They really help make sure that all of our work is straight, getting out subpoenas, getting out documents that have to be filed with the court, and helping us organize things, gather statistics, and that sort of thing. So these are very important groups that we have in our office. Now, before I discuss some of those other issues that we had, we'll talk about grand jury and the general criminal process. Any questions about what I've talked about so far? How we're organized?
Of those administrative people and investigators, are some of the lawyers here?
No.
Is that something that a lawyer would typically get involved with?
No, generally.
How do they learn the job on the job?
Yeah, well, they learn the job on it. Well, let me say this. Most of the investigators who work for me, they're all certified police officers, except for that one who's half a victim, who's half investigator. All certified police officers. And they have learned about the criminal process through their prior experience for the most part. Now, my chief investigator actually started out of his degree in criminal justice from the University of South Carolina in our office as a district attorney's investigator. These are, frankly, kind of desired jobs. It's hard to get rid of an investigator in our office because they enjoy the work. We try very hard to pay them fairly, and so they just never leave. That's good because they get used to the process. But he grew up in the process, and they don't need to be lawyers, but they help us a lot because of their knowledge of criminal law in general, how a jury might perceive a case or a particular witness, their advice and consultation is just as important to us as working with another lawyer in the case, particularly with the investigators. Did that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Any other questions about kind of how we're set up? I want to tell you that my chief ADA for Dawson County, I have a chief ADA over the whole circuit, who's Juan Vance. For Dawson County, we call him our supervising assistant district attorney. And he is Conley Greer, and he can always be reached at the Dawson County District Attorney's Office. Conley Greer, C-O-N-L-E-Y. He's one of three veterans that we have working for us. I like to hire veterans because they really have good work ethic, and they got a lot more for them. Conley Greer doesn't have a problem with hairdo or anything, because he doesn't have any. But he really is a good fella, and so he's my supervising ADA, and I've got two others. Perk Doherty works for me as an ADA, and then also Jennifer Geller is an ADA in the Dawson County office. We have, I think it's about even now, it's close to even, but we used to have more women assistant district attorneys than we do have men. It's just kind of a function of law schools and all that sort of thing, but our jobs have also been good for a young women who have families. You know, it's harder for a woman to have a baby and keep a job and all that sort of thing, and it's much easier when you're in the public sector to do that. Recently lost some really good employees. Lindsay Burton was my chief assistant district attorney. She's now juvenile court judge. Allison Tolker was an assistant district attorney for me, been there for years. She's now a juvenile court judge. And so I lost both of them, but we were able to hire a couple of other young people, young men actually, both of whom were veterans, and they've done very well in picking up the job and going on. Most of my attorneys have, I've got one guy that is a little bit younger than I am, and he's been doing it for over 25 years. Most of them are 40-ish, some are in their very late 20s, late 30s, that kind of thing. So I have somewhat of a young staff, and I still think of myself as young, although I do not live in the 30s. I just know that particular fact about Mr. and Mr. Attorney. Any other questions on that subject first? Let me talk a little bit about the criminal process. Particularly, Dale thought that y'all might be interested in the grand jury process. I know Robert McCullough, who is the district attorney in the Ferguson, St. Louis area, because I am the Georgia representative on the board of the National District Attorneys Association, and he is also on that association. So I know him to be a fine man of terrific integrity. And the way he used the grand jury in that case, and I don't want to give that a negative connotation, use the grand jury in that case, but what he did was allow that grand jury, who was made up of citizens in the community, to hear all of the evidence involved, all of the evidence involved. A grand jury generally does not work that way. Who has ever served on grand jury among this group? Any of you served on Dawson County grand jury? How long ago did you serve?
Atlanta.
In Atlanta?
Yeah.
Okay. In Atlanta, I bet they're more rapid fire than they are.
We were indicting, it was out about 37 seconds per case.
Yeah.
We do like 50 a day.
Yeah. We're a little bit slower in Dawson County and in Hall County. When I worked in Savannah, every ADA had one Wednesday a month that they presented their cases. And a lot of times I'd bring a witness, swear the witness, ask him to tell the truth, or her to tell the truth. And I would lead the witness on every single question. You know, didn't this happen? Didn't this happen? And their answer would be yes or no. Thank you, ma'am. Get up, walk out. You know, because we had to do it so much. We had to really move in the process. We take a good deal more time than that in Dawson County as well as in Hall County. Grand jury is an interesting process because there are no evidentiary rules in grand jury. Hearsay is completely admissible. Most hearsay is admissible, by the way, in most trials because there are so many exceptions to the hearsay rule that are legitimate. But you're going to hear a lot of what would technically be hearsay even in a jury trial because of exceptions to the rule. But in grand jury, there are no exceptions to the rule because there is no rule. So as a result of that, it's usually the investigating officer or the investigating detective who is the sole witness, who is a sworn witness, but he's or she is telling the grand jury about the case, about their investigation, what this person said, what this person said, what this physical evidence was, how all this came about. And their finding is essentially a probable cause finding. Is there probable cause sufficient to take these charges that have been presented to us in a bill of indictment to a traverse jury? After that point, the traverse jury is the 12 in a box who decide the case beyond a reasonable doubt unanimously in Georgia. Doesn't have to be unanimous. People think that's constitutional. It doesn't have to be. In Florida, they have many 9-3 verdicts and things like of that nature. But in Georgia, it's all unanimous. In misdemeanor cases, generally, your jury, a traverse jury is going to be 6-6. Now, how you get on the grand jury? That changed in 2011. Before 2011, July 1, 2011, I think to be exact, the grand jurors were chosen by the jury commissioners. And by law, they were supposed to look at citizens in the community and choose among those citizens the most, and the law referred to them in this fashion, the most upright and intelligent people in the community to serve. Now, it didn't always end up that way because I had to make a judgment about something. But that was what the requirement of the law was. So grand jury was a pick and choose sort of situation. Grand jury also had to meet certain requirements. Had to have, and Georgia was really kind of the only state that did this, but it had to have certain percentages of Caucasians, certain percentages of African Americans, certain percentages of Hispanic people, certain percentages of various groups. And if it didn't do that, you're going to get a challenge to the grand jury. And we fought that battle many times in the Supreme Court. And we generally won it. And usually it was only in death penalty cases. But it was a real complicated process for the jury commissioners to put on the grand jury pool, which is a different pool than the traverse jury pool. Those kinds of percentages in the pool, they didn't have to be that percentage in the particular grand jury, they just had to be that percentage available in the pool. And that became a real challenge over time. So the Georgia legislature, with the district's encouragement and others, decided to make grand jurors chosen in the same way that Travis Shores have chosen. So the list is much more expansive now because the list is drawn from driver's license list, voter registration list, I think there are one or two other lists from which the Travis Shores are all placed. And many, 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 many more people are now on the list of possibly being chosen to serve on a Travis jury or a grand jury than there were before, because we don't have to worry about the percentages anymore, and because the effort was made to make it more inclusive. Of course, the defense attorneys, when they filed these motions about grand jury, always said, you need to do it this way, or you're doing it wrong. You need to make it more inclusive. So we then made it more inclusive. And now the grand jury challenges are, you've done it wrong, you just did it wrong. You need to change the whole thing. You know, you need to find something else, whatever. Yeah, they'll get people down. There are people who are paid to testify in that sort of way. But it's actually worked out pretty good. And I think many more people are getting to serve on grand juries that might not get to serve before, simply because they weren't known by the jury commissioners. And it might not be a problem for a group of jury commissioners in Dawson County to know a good many people in Dawson County, but they're still not going to know everybody. And now more people get the opportunity to serve on grand jury. Now that presented some problems, because we were getting some people on grand jury pools who were not eligible to serve. Convicted felons, people that moved out of the county, that sort of thing. And so we have to spend more time on every time a grand jury meets to try to call out those people who are not eligible to serve. You got to be able to speak English. You got to be a citizen of the United States. You can't be just a legal resident. More of a problem in Hall County than it is in Dawson County. But we spend a lot more time calling out that. Now, grand jury consists of 23 people. We also can choose three alternates on above that, but we can't have any more than 23 people in the room considering a particular case at a particular time. If I have 21 people show up and two alternates are also there, they will fill in those remaining slots. We had a problem once. The grand jury, they got to be very responsible. When this thing first changed, they called the same number of people summoned to get possibly chosen for grand jury. And when they did that, a fewer percentage of those people showed up. And so on one particular occasion, we couldn't get a full grand jury. We couldn't get 23 people. We only had 18. Second time, about 18, then only 15 showed up. We had to send everybody home, pay everybody, and pay the off-duty police officers, that sort of thing. So now they've summoned more people in, and the law has changed where we can draw from the Travis jury pools to fill the grand jury pool in the event that not enough grand jurors have been chosen to fill the grand jury. So we're not having that problem right now. Now, not all felony cases have to go to grand jury. That changed in April of 1992, where many felony cases, like habitual violators, you've been caught in DUI for three times in the last 5 years, you're therefore an habitual violator, and it's a felony for you to even drive a car. We used to have to present all of those cases to the grand jury, and all forgery cases, and all minor thefts, and all every felony case had to go to grand jury. 1992, the legislature made a list of cases that we don't have to present to the grand jury. And we can file those in a document that's called an accusation. Georgia is the only state in the union who calls such a document an accusation. An accusation is filed by the district attorney, him or herself. In much the way what every other state in the union calls an information. Not every state has to go to grand jury for every case either. But they call them informations, we call them accusations, simply because we're Georgia and we want to be different or something. So we do file a lot of cases like that. When we consider a case comes into our office, and we consider whether to go forward or not go forward. And we call out a lot of cases, 8% of the relatively small percentage of cases that way, in cases that maybe ought to be dismissed before we go further. And so we do that kind of judgment about cases. Now, in the Ferguson case, well, let me tell you this generally speaking, and then I'll move to first. So in grand jury, you don't have to have a unanimous vote. If there are 21 people in the room, because two people have excused themselves for some reason or another, you still have to have a majority of 23 voting in favor of a true bill. So a true bill is that stamp on the bill of indictment that makes it go forward to the next stage. So you always have to have a majority of 23. But only that, so 12 people say, okay, this case needs to go forward for Traverse Street, South of the 90s, guilty or innocent, that's all the determination that has to be made. It's just the majority of 23 people. I have sometimes in my career, and it's kind of rare, used grand jury in the same fashion that Robert McCullough used the grand jury first. And that is where there was some question about the case or some public or there was a family who was particularly upset about their loved one having been killed. But the evidence is pretty clear that it's probably a self-defense matter. You know, if it's so clearly self-defense that we know we're not going to go forward, I mean, there was a shooting at the Georgia State Patrol just yesterday, we're not going to go forward for that officer having shot the young man who was walking toward them having shot, fired shots at him. Okay. The officer was shot right in the shoulder, and he's still living. Oh, that's okay. Or the young man in the shoulder. We're not going to prosecute that case. It was a justifiable shooting. We don't have to take that grand jury. I can just decide I'm not going to do that. So, did. And I mean, we won't in that particular case. Because it's just so patently obvious. And I haven't read the reports yet, but I showed up yesterday at the GSB and I talked to everybody involved. Closer question, whether it's a self-defense or not, and the family said, well, my son was working. We might take that case and do a day-long or two-day-long presentation of all the evidence. We would try the case as if we were in a jury trial, in front of a jury, giving them all the information, questioning witnesses thoroughly, calling the actual witnesses, not just relying on the hearsay from the officers. And that's what Rob McCullough did first, because there were some eyewitnesses who at one point had said that the young man who was shot and killed was running toward the officer and walking toward the officer. This is what it was, walking toward the officer with his hands up, don't shoot. Well, there were many other witnesses who said, no, that wasn't so. What he was doing was charging the officer after there had already been an altercation. He called many, many, many lay witnesses, both for one side of that issue, what they saw, and the other side of the issue, what they saw. And he allowed the grand jury to make the determination about whether to take that case further along than it already was. And the grand jury in the first case decided not to do so. They decided not to indict the police officer. There should be a name first, and I don't remember his name. Oh, and I should. And any young man shot, regardless of the circumstance, you ought to be able to remember his name. Do you remember what it was, anybody?
The one who was shot?
Yeah, the one who was shot.
Michael Warren?
Yeah, Michael Warren. Right. And, so that was one way he approached allowing the grand jury, because there were citizens in the community, to make the determination about that. Now that's pretty rare to do all that because, first of all, when a magistrate issues a warrant, the magistrate does it on the basis of probable cause. The police officer says, I swear this is the evidence of the case. The magistrate decides, well, that's sufficient probable cause, so I'm going to issue a warrant. The person's arrested. The person goes to the first appearance. The document itself shows on its face probable cause. So it says, okay, well, this case, you want a commitment hearing or not? Guy chooses a commitment hearing, goes to a commitment hearing. At the commitment hearing, probable cause is found that the crime can go forward for further prosecution. And then the grand jury, after the committal hearing, probable cause is found by the grand jury. So there are many steps along the process where probable cause is found by either an individual or by a group of people to determine that the case can go forward for a travel jury to be decided. Now, we also, of course, evaluate the cases within our office and determine whether we should go forward or not. And if something ought to be so painfully dismissed, we just dismiss it. But sometimes we'll take it to the grand jury and let them make the decision about it. Now, because we're screening cases and because the procedure like was followed in Ferguson is so rare, if a grand jury hears in any term of court, there are two terms of court in Dawson County. Grand jury hears, say, 65 cases during that term. They are likely to indict 65 or 64 of the cases and no bill one, two, something like that. Because it's already been through a great deal of screening. And as a result of that, one of the phrases is that a grand jury can indict a ham sandwich. Well, the fact of the matter is that most of the cases that are made are good cases in the sense that they should go forward and be decided by a traverse jury. And jury doesn't make decisions about guilt or innocence, guilty or not guilty. And I like to distinguish between them because legally, not guilty is not the same as innocence. I like to say that there's really only one who knows what true innocence is. And he ain't us. So that there's legal not guilty or guilty. And they're not making that determination. They're saying in this case I'll be determined by somebody else. Now that's sort of a general overview of grand jury. Any questions about the grand jury process? Yes,
what is the length of a normal service when you've been chosen?
Okay. Well, let me give two examples. In Dawson County, we have two terms of court. One is in February and the other is in September. And you serve for a full 6-month period, but you might only actually be in the grand jury room considering cases 2 days of that 6 month. The first day that you show up and a second scheduled day at later time, 3 at the max. Even after we excuse a grand jury, we can call a grand jury back within the same term. We have done that before. Y'all might remember Gary Hilton case from years ago in Dawson County,
yeah,
a few years ago. Gary Hilton, you might recall, kidnapped a woman with blood pound, not in our circuit, another circuit, and beheaded her in Dawson County. And we worked it out because the district attorney in the circuit above me, who is not the present district attorney there now, Jeff Langley, not him, but his predecessor, work out a deal with the defense and show us where the body is, and I'm sure we will just take the death penalty off the table. So he pretty much had made a decision for I could have made a legal argument about that, but it was going to be difficult. And the statement that he, 2.5 to 3 hour statement that he made during that process was likely not to be admissible because they didn't give him Miranda and they made a promise to take the death penalty off the table. So we felt compelled, really, in the end, to say, okay, look, we'll live up to taking the death penalty off the table as this other district attorney decided, because he couldn't decide my case, but he didn't know the body was going to be in Dawson County at that point. So we'll do that, but you got to plead within 30 days. She was kidnapped on January 1. He was in court on January 31st, closing his case, within 30 days. And we had to indict the case that morning, so we had to call the grand jury back and indict the case that morning because even though a person can waive grand jury, you can't waive grand jury on a murder case. So a grand jury is subject to recall. It's fairly rare, although we just did it in the last term, not the present term of Dawson County as well. But Dawson County goes for 2 days. Now, Hall County, you're on a grand jury, there's some 2-month terms and some 4-month terms. Two-month terms, 2 4-month terms. And if you're on either term, you're going to meet 1 day at a time every 2 weeks during your term, but just 1 day at a time. That's how it works. So
not as big a
commitment
fall to a private business person.
That's right.
You're not talking about a 2 month tour of duty.
Right.
Where you have to just let your.
And generally, the tours of duty for a traverse jury, generally speaking, are 1 week at a time. But one of our Superior Court judges, Judge Fuller, has been known to pick juries on Friday afternoon, Daniel, and have them come back the next week as well, when they've been on call all week. And so it sometimes can be difficult for a private citizen, I understand that. But serving on traverse juries and grand jury is very important for citizens to do. Very important for citizens to do. It's your voice in the criminal justice system. And, you know, I can take in a case, I can take in the best case in the world. I might say that this case involving this person is the best case in the world. Grand jury can laugh at me, return a Nobel, and I'm done if they do that twice. I can take back a case, if they Nobel it once, I can take it back to either the same grand jury or to another grand jury. If the grand jury Nobels it twice, I'm done. That's the end of the case. So they do have that power. But most of your grand jurors are, in fact, going to indict the cases that we present to them, because that's generally what we're asking for.
Question?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you go ahead?
Oh, I'm sorry.
You mentioned earlier that you needed 23 for a case and only 18 showed up. What happens to those people who don't show up?
Well, in that particular case, there were enough people that showed up, but there were so many ineligible people that they had to be excused. And those that didn't show up, the clerk's office, this is what the judges tell me. I'm not sure how it's worked in actual practice, but checks and see, does further investigation to determine they have a correct address, whether the person's moved, that sort of thing. And nothing happens when we know that they've moved or know that they're ineligible. If they are eligible and don't show up, the judge has something to say about it. And in the worst of cases, the judge even has the power to arrest somebody for contempt or something of that nature. But the idea is that you're supposed to show up, you know. At that time, when we only were able to choose 18 from the grand jury, and only 15 showed up on the second day, one of the two people had really good excuses for not being there. The third had not. I called him, I called his work, I called his home, did everything I could to get in touch with him. And finally, I told the judge what the problem was, and we had to pay all the grand jurors, taxpayer money. And that was a shame. But the judge, so the judge called me and said, well, what should we do? And I said, well, I think you have the power of contempt, and you can hold him the max I have to arrest him. But I said, maybe I'll just call him and say, we are going to look into what our options are, unless you show up next time. And he decided he didn't want her to look into the options, so he came in next time. And was the grand jury. So it's important. And I tell all the grand jurors, on the first day, we got 22 people there. I tell them all, on the second day, we have to have a quorum of at least 16 people. And some people can be excused for various good reasons, but you got to be responsible to each other. And we don't want that situation to happen again. Your question, sir.
Several questions. One, which branch of government does the grand jury belong to?
Well, I would say it was the judicial branch of government, and not so much the executive branch, but I would say judicial branch.
Which branch of government has authority over a grand jury, legal authority, where the law says?
Right. Well, the legislative branch can make the laws that are related to the grand jury. For example, all the rules that I talked about, 23 people on grand jury, 3 aldermen, 7, all of those came out of the legislature. So the legislative branch would do that. The executive branch has to sign off on it when the law is changed related to grand jury.
When you run out of criminal cases, which I hope you do frequently.
Well, a job of prosecutor is to put himself out of one, you know. But and I often tell people, until the word comes back, that ain't gonna happen.
Yeah, I understand. But let's say that you run short cases 1 week and the grand jury sitting there on Wednesday afternoon, nothing else to do. And one of them decides, hey, I heard this. I think we need to go look at that.
Yeah.
Now, do you interject yourself, or is it their decision whether they conduct their investigation?
There are only certain limited things that they can do. I don't have all those memorized or listed, but the grand jury doesn't have general investigative power to look into anything that they might want to.
Well, now that's peculiar because their oath says that they will diligently inquire and true presentment make of all matters.
Presented to them for their consideration.
Touching upon their present service, so, you know.
And what we're talking about that is bills of indictment, for example. So, I mean, the grand jury is just, it's not a generalized group for, you know, a group of citizens to decide, well, we want to do this about the government or whatever, just in general terms. Now, they have some inspection duties, and there are, they can, you know, require the county to give an accounting of all county funds. I mean, it used to be that the county commission required to bring over a box of money. These are the funds that we have. They have inspection duties of the jail, inspection duties of my office, inspection duties generally speaking. But they don't have a general investigative power to simply decide as a group of people, we are going to look into this matter. I can't, for example, say to them, I don't know whether I'm going to indict this case or not. I've got to present them a bill of indictment for them to consider. I've got to give them a bill of indictment. I can't just come in with a bunch of witnesses or an individual citizen who says, I want this matter looked into. And I don't have the power, and neither does that citizen have the power to tell the grand jury, I want y'all to bring this indictment against this person.
Well, now that's peculiar because the Constitution clearly states that a citizen has the right to petition those vested with the power of government for a redress of his grievance. And if he thinks it's a grand jury, then do you have any authority to obstruct his access to the grand jury? Or is it the grand jury's duty to tell him whether or not they can hear his complaint?
I would simply say in general terms that it's going to be the presiding judge of the grand jury who can decide whether or not a particular matter can be presented to the grand jury beyond the bills of indictment that I presented.
Well, where is that in code? Where is that specified in Georgia code that a superior court judge has authority over the grand jury judge?
Well, superior court, there's always a presiding judge for the grand jury for that particular term.
That's
always
correct.
Available to that particular grand jury in a particular term.
That's correct, but he is an assistant. Our court finally got around to clarifying the word supervision when it applied to judges and grand juries. They interpreted it as being an assistant to the grand jury, not someone who has control. We have a long string of cases in the state of Georgia that clearly indicate that the grand jury is an independent court of inquiry.
What?
Populated by 23 judges.
And if I may call you,
Paul. Yeah.
I really don't want to fight with you about that, and that's not what I'm really trying to do. I understand your point of view about that, and I think it's a strong point of view that many people have. I wish I had memorized for you. I could sit here and read all the grand jury statutes that are related to the charge of the grand jury, what the legislature allows them to look at or not look at. But there's not a general investigative power where they can just investigate anything they want to. Now, I'm bound by the law and not by the opinion of many people. And I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm not fighting with you. But I am bound by the law and what the law is, and not by general opinion about what the grand jury ought to be able to do.
If you take Henry Lester from 1886, if you take Cook v. Sykes from 1953, you have a situation where citizens are authorized to go to the grand jury uninvited, either in person or by attorney, and lay out their problem to the grand jury. The grand jury make the decision in those two cases. Now, I will grant you, Lester was a victim. However, thanks to the full faith and credit clause of the U.S. Constitution, along came Maryland and Illinois in 1940 and 44, and they changed that victim in the case law precedent, and that's never been overturned. So clearly the grand jury does not need the direction either from the district attorney or the judge, because their oath plainly says, and Article 1, Section 1, Paragraph 11 of the Georgia Constitution clearly makes it clear that they are judges. There's 23 judges. The minute they're sworn in, they become judges. And the Constitution says they shall judge the facts and the law. So if there's no law that prohibits them from having general criminal investigative responsibility, then they are not prohibited from interpreting the lack of a prohibition as authority to go ahead and investigate crime, wherever and in whatever guise it may appear. We could get into a lively debate over this.
Oh, we probably could. And I obviously you have some really good knowledge about specific cases that relate to this particular issue. I can say, having been a lawyer since 1979, that there is probably a group of people who could write a brief that might directly contradict all of the things that you said.
They wouldn't have the precedent backing them up, nor would they have the black.
But they would say otherwise.
But let's leave that up to a grand jury. Yeah. After all, they're the judges of the law.
Okay. Thank you, Paul.
Along those lines, are you saying that it's prohibited by law for a grand juror to look into something, or are you saying it's just not customary that a grand juror themselves would go to you and say, hey, I think we need to look at this more closely. I've got information that, you know, leads me to believe this is something we need to look at.
Well, I can tell you this. There have been some circumstances during my tenure as district attorney where, I will give you one example along those lines. There was and I'm not going to name any names or companies, but I'll tell you, generally, it was a chicken plant. And the chicken plant was had a fellow working for him, and I'll just pull the name out of the air in Hispanic name, say Jose Rodriguez. Jose Rodriguez worked. And it was found out that Jose Rodriguez was actually some other Hispanic name. And that person got charged with using a false identification. Well, about 3 weeks passed, and Jose Rodriguez, the person they knew as Jose Rodriguez, came back as Christopher O'Malley. And Christopher O'Malley was a Caucasian, an actual real person in another state who had been getting, had gotten word of this and all that sort of thing. In other words, he used a different identity. They knew who he was. They knew him as Jose Rodriguez, but when he came back as Christopher O'Malley, they just hired him. Well, the grand jury was upset about that. And they asked if we could have a meeting with some of the officers of the corporation. And we did have that meeting. And I arranged for that to occur. So it's not beyond absolute precedence for something like that to happen. But that was also related to a particular case, and they were concerned about that. Grand juries in Dawson County have looked at various issues. There was a special committee that related to this building many years ago. I don't remember all the details of that. I just don't. But they looked at it. Two consecutive grand juries looked at the issue that involved whether the handling of the sale. I just don't remember the details. I really don't. I wasn't district attorney at the time. But whether or not all that was within the bounds of the law. If the grand jury told me we would like to see the county commissioner, I would tell Mike Berg the grand jury wants to see you, and Mike Berg's likely to show up, and they're likely to be able to talk to him about anything that they want to. So this kind of thing that Paul's talking about is not without some precedence, but generally speaking, the grand jury, and I'm not going to write a brief one, I'm not going to argue. I'd be pleased to have a copy of it. It's not just where any citizen can just show up at the grand jury and say, I've got this problem with this person. I want y'all to deal with it. It just doesn't happen in that way. Now, I have told people before, if you would please just tell me what the issue is, I will give it to the full person, and the full person can make a decision. along with the grand jury about whether or not they want to invite you in. And we recently, there was a former county commissioner who frankly had an issue about annexation, and he just wanted to address the grand jury about the issue generally, about whether Dawsonville could annex this or annex that, and he was allowed to do that. So the kind of thing that you're talking about is not without precedence. It is, to answer your question more directly than that, it is not customary and it's not frequent, but that kind of thing happens on occasion.
So basically what you're saying is that every citizen can at least petition the grand jury for, right? As far as you're concerned.
If a citizen calls me and says, I've got this particular concern and I'm concerned that it might be criminal in nature, I would ask that person, give me an outline, I'll talk with the foreperson, and the foreperson can make a decision.
Oh, so you're saying that you would interpose your person between that citizen and
the grand jury? Well, the citizens generally call me.
Pardon?
The citizens generally call me.
Well, generally, yeah, but I'm saying in a situation where a citizen petitions directly with
the grand jury. I'm not going to suggest this particular process, but if any citizen knows that the foreperson of the grand jury is and writes that foreperson and says, well, I'd like to address the grand jury about I'm not always in the room when they're voting on a criminal case. It's not to say that the grand jury has any power to do anything about that, but you know what I'm saying? Because they don't generally can't just do everything that they might want to do. They can't consider a criminal case. For example, if a bill of indictment is not before them for their consideration. Criminal case. They can't consider a criminal case unless a bill of indictment is before them for consideration. Yeah. Now that's the truth.
You need to read it.
Okay.
Am I right? Well, I'll
yes, sir.
Want to have you send it to you.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
That's an interesting discussion, but we need to move along. No comments.
Sure.
All right.
You want to go to another application? This is a very interesting issue because, sometimes statutes say something, that's the legislative branch, and yet the judicial branch might say something a little bit different in the way they interpret the statutes, and that's the kind of way it works. There is a statute that's called 17527, use of force in execution of search warrant. All necessary and reasonable force may be used to effect an entry into any building or property or part thereof execute a search warrant if after verbal notice or an attempt in good faith to give verbal notice by the officer directed to execute the same of his authority in person, one, he has refused admittance, or two, the person's a person within the building or property thereof or part thereof, refused to acknowledge and answer the verbal notice of the presence of the person or persons therein is unknown to the officer, or building or property or part thereof is not then occupied by any person. In other words, this essentially says that you got to announce yourself. But the judicial branch looks into it a little bit further. This is where the no-knock provision comes in. It comes from case law more than the statutory law. Because the statutory law seems to say that, again, reasonable force, but you've got to get verbal notice, directed to execute the same with this authority person, refused admittance, and that sort of thing. So that seems to imply that you've got to knock and announce who you are. However, that has been both in United States Supreme Court jurisprudence and in Georgia jurisprudence. Not really modified, but explained that there are some circumstances where no knock provision in a search warrant is appropriate. And I would say that these are pretty rare. The ones you hear about where there are difficulties with them are, that happens. The cases, there are a lot more shootings of police officers and police officers shooting other people than are ever reported on the news. That's the same kind of with no-knock provisions. You only hear about very few things. But there was a case in 1991, for example, where there was no allegation of increased peril to the officers or of danger that evidence would be destroyed. And it said a no-knock provision should not have been included in that warrant. And in some cases, depending on whether or not the court looks at it as being reasonable or not reasonable, that is the use of a no-knock provision, sometimes the seizure of certain items can be, in fact, suppressed by the court. It depends on reasonableness. And it relates to two primary issues. Are the officers who are executing the search warrant in danger, in significant danger, unless they can just go in without announcing themselves? Or two, is there a significant risk of evidence being destroyed if they do announce themselves? Those are the two issues that are involved in no-knock provisions in search warrants. We very rarely see them. A search warrant we did the other day had all the standard forms have no-knock provisions on them, and it's very clear. And unless the judge finds that there's probable cause to believe that the officers may well be in danger of getting harmed, or there's significant risk of evidence being destroyed, a judge cannot sign the no-knock provision on the search warrant. And those are the primary issues. Now, some of the cases talk about an officer can go up and knock on the door, nobody responds. 3 to 5 seconds is enough time for them to go ahead and break down the door when nobody responds. There have been cases that said even that is sufficient time. This bell ringing, by the way, is my phone, so maybe I should just turn it off.
We don't cost a dollar.
We don't mind the music.
Yeah. My daughter wrote me, says, immediate family, I miss y'all so much. We were on the beach last week. And I miss them too. And I'll turn it off for right now. So, and there was another case, though, for example, trial court erred in denying the defendant's suppressive motion as the law enforcement officers executing a search warrant which did not contain a no-knock provision for defendant's department failed to comply with the statute that I was talking about. And so they threw out his drug convictions because exigent circumstances to justify a forced entry without not announcement were not established in that case. So the court said if exigent circumstances sufficient to justify entry without knocking and announcing, then they could have gone in. So they suppressed the evidence in that case. But not every case is suppressible, even if the statute has not been complied with. Now, there was an effort in the legislature, a lot of argument about no-knock provisions and search warrants, it just never happened. There were some slight modifications to search warrant law. There was a bigger case. Some of the provisions being considered, I think Kevin may have talked about this, I don't know. Cameras being worn by police officers. There are some people that believe that cameras ought not be worn by police officers in any circumstances. There are some people that believe cameras ought to be worn by police officers, except when you're in a private home. And there's some, they're just all over the board, what different people believe about that. And I guess one example that was given by one of the prosecutors that was working with the Prosecuting Attorney's Council was, if there's a great deal of noise in the house and it sounds like somebody's being attacked and the officer has got a camera on, as it is right now, without a change in that law, as it has been, I think they may well have changed it this time, but as it has been, if an officer films within the private home, then he could be convicted of a felony. So I guess an example was given when it was pressed that maybe have cameras in all circumstances for the protection of the officers, for the protection of other people involved, and for the truth about the facts of the case. You know, are you supposed to go into a domestic violence situation and say to the person who's wielding a baseball bat and about to hit his wife with it, excuse me, sir, do you mind if I film this while you do that? Do you mind if I record this on my camera while you do that? I mean, that's what the law seemed to be. Otherwise, the officer might be committing a crime. So that's an issue a lot of people feel strong about, and both ways or no, because if it's a private home, the use of the camera in a private home, et cetera. But is there a legitimate law enforcement purposes to use a camera in most circumstances? I think this day and age, you know, cameras are ubiquitous, to use a big word. I bet you know that one too. It just seems like to me that more truth can come out, the more that officers can use cameras to actually show what the incident was, rather than that, that's my memory. I mean, this officer's recently indicted for murder for shooting a man in the back several times while that man was running away from him. That was perfectly appropriate, and had there not been a citizen with a camera, we'd not been able to see that. So that was important. I mean, there's really not a whole lot to no-knock provisions except that, unless there are some other questions about it. It's just it depends on circumstances and about whether the officer can justify exigent circumstances so that they can go into a home without knocking and announcing. And those two issues are whether or not the officer might be in danger of physical injury, or there's a significant risk that evidence might be destroyed unless you can do that. And it can't be just a generalized sort of statement that drug dealers might well try to put their evidence in the toilet. You know, it can't be generalized. It's got to be more specific on a case-by-case basis. You have a question?
Well, my concern with you mentioned the two criteria for the no-knock. Right. One being whether or not the officer or officers would be in jeopardy of physical harm,
right,
trying to execute the warrant,
right,
or whether or not potential evidence could be destroyed in the process. That's a pretty broad definition. It leaves a lot of latitude out there. But aside from that, you said normally they would consider 3 to 5 seconds if you don't answer your door, that would give them reason to go in. I want to
one case of tax.
Yeah. Well, I want to know how many people here can get up and answer the phone in 3 to 5 seconds when it starts ringing. If you're in one room and the phone's in.
Depends on how long you've been sitting in the recliner.
Yeah.
And how fast.
No, but if somebody enters my home, my gun comes out, and I don't care if they're a police officer or
well,
not.
That was
if they
my
could be dressed
my,
like
my
one,
other
that's
concern is that, you know, that there may be some very specific instances where a no-knock would really be justifiable. If it was someone with a known history of violence towards police or something, I could see that. But
in most circumstances, that's what the courts are going to require.
Right. Well, I'm going to say that there's a level.
Somebody with a known history, somebody even a prior history of destroying evidence. If you have that sort of evidence, the court is more likely to uphold a no-knock entry. And they motion to suppress the evidence.
Well, you know, my only concern is that you,
be generalized.
You've heard these stories of certain people that maybe express unpopular opinions. And then someone calls up the sheriff's office at 11 o'clock at night and says, I'm so-and-so, I live at such-and-such, I just shot my wife, I'm going to kill my kids. Then they show up.
And they go in.
And they go in and everybody's asleep. I mean, that, in my thought, without any kind of
cooperating evidence,
you want to put the police in more jeopardy than otherwise.
In that particular circumstance, the man calls up and says, I live at this address, and I mean, it's come through a 911 call, it's come, they can even verify that generally. I live at this address, I've just shot my wife, I'm going to kill my children. The police officers have the right to go in there and go into that house, and they don't have to knock and announce themselves under those circumstances. See, that's a case-by-case particular thing where there's danger to other people.
And I think the issue with that one was that they did not verify that that phone call actually came from that residence. It was a cell phone. So,
right. And they ought to do more to verify that circumstance. I don't know the end result of that case if you're familiar.
Well, everything was sorted out after everybody was upset and embarrassed and handcuffed. It was all clear, but my concern is that it's such a dangerous precedent for police. I mean, they've already suffered enough as it is, the way things are. But to use that as a way to go in, you know, Well, why not just give them a call and tell them you're coming, you know?
The law says that you really have to be, no not provisions, you have to exercise special care to make sure that you can justify the existing circumstances to ask the issuing magistrate for the no not provision. This guy got shot at the GSP the other day, and he was shot in return. We did search warrants for his car, we did search warrants for his house. There were no no-knock provisions on those. There weren't any necessity on those. There weren't any exigent circumstances to believe that there ought to be. Even if he had, there was no evidence of this, but even if he had killed or harmed somebody else before he got there, he was no longer there.
Right, but if you go back to a little bit further back in time where they executed one in Northeast Georgia with flashbang, and a child was gravely injured, if not dead, that, you know,
that's right.
That may have been one that they'd like to have taken back as far as issue the no-knock, because apparently there was nothing there which they thought was going to be there.
That's right.
And that's the tragedy of it. You know,
sometimes
criminals go free, then one innocent person be harmed. So
I mean, I'm not disagreeing with you here. There are sometimes that officers need to have more information, and magistrates need to make sure that there's more information before they put a no-knock provision in a search warrant. I think you have to be very careful about no-knock provisions. I think it would be a mistake to take them out of the law completely, and under no circumstances can you go in without an announcement. Mm-hmm. You're knocking on the door and announcing who you are. I think that would be a mistake to do that, but I think much more care needs to be exercised in proving that you actually need it.
Agreed.
And the magistrate making a neutral and detached determination that actual need is there. Because the tragedy like happened in North Georgia with that baby, I mean, it's just horrible. I mean, that kind of thing should not happen. And I remember when there was one in Atlanta where there was, I think, a grandmother was killed or something.
Very similar, yes.
I think, was that an entry even into a wrong house?
No, it wasn't the wrong house. That was Catherine Johnston. And they intentionally used her address. And then they got a no-knock search warrant by phone.
Well, like I say, I think much more care needs to be exercised than no-knock warrants. I'm getting kind of a notice that my time is kind of running out. This is very interesting to be in this conversation. I appreciate that. And I'd be glad to receive any material that you have.
Well,
real quick.
What statute authorizes the courts of this state to issue a form for judges to use that is not authorized in statutes?
Well, there is no statute that relates to no-knock provisions.
That's correct.
This one that I talked to, but the judicial branch is empowered with the ability to interpret statutes.
Interpret is one thing, but judicial legislation, you and I both know that's illegal at all.
Yes, and that sometimes happens, and we don't like it either when we're talking about judicial legislation, but we're going to follow the law wherever it falls.
Wouldn't that be a good case for a grand jury to look at? Thank
you. I'm certainly not the authority here, but I think Kevin Tanner is really trying to examine that, trying to codify what you do and what you can't do.
That'd be probably a bad idea than simply the judicial pronouncements come down, because they are decided on a case-by-case basis as it is presently.
Right. We'll try and get more information probably on that, but Kevin is trying to do something. He got slammed pretty hard trying to be an organizer. And I think that he had other priorities in this last legislative session.
I attended some of the legislation, and the process that they go through down there is kind of crazy.
But anyway, I think I think that might be something good that you all want to talk to him about, and tell him that you support him in doing this, and that he's not wasting his time. But anyway, thank you very much. Very informative. Appreciate you taking the time. Good luck getting the badass. I didn't introduce some other new faces. Is Derek?
Patrick Bush.
Patrick.
Mike Chris.
And Mike works in the Sheriff's Department.
Kind of serving.
Right. And we haven't seen him before, so glad to see you. And Jamie, I'm not sure we know that.
Jamie Black, and now just interested in our country and supporting it, so.
Glad to hear.
What do I do?
No, actually, we're glad you're here. Tell us what you do.
Well, I'm an IT project manager with Appalachia. I work out my home here in Dawsonville.
Right, right, good to see you. Well, the last piece of business I've got is to tell you who won our book tonight, and that's Jeff Johnson. Thank you very much. So we're adjourned till next week, until next month. You know, we'd like, I wanted to have a meeting as close to July 4th as I could, but you know, we always meet on the second Tuesday of the month, which puts it pretty late in July. So, I mean, it's all the way up to July 14th. So, you know, we may change it next month and go the first Tuesday, but we'll keep you informed by email on our email.
That's a tough week though for vacations and stuff, too. I'd leave it the second, I'd leave it the 14th.
You think so? Okay. We'll still celebrate the 4th of July when we get here. So thank you for coming. Travel safe home, or travel home safe. What have I forgotten? Nydia Tisdale's back here recording, and I don't know if you know her or not. If you haven't met Nydia, you should shake her hand and get to know her.
It's actually,
you got an announcement?
It's pronounced Nydia. It rhymes with Lydia, and it starts with the letter N. Nydia Tisdale. And the video of tonight's meeting will be available on YouTube.
Great. And what's the website?
It's youtube.com/Nydia Tisdale.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much. Good to see you, bye.